pretend to be where the light and darkness meet on the edge of the horizon through the trees. I am a narcissist, crippled with self-doubt. I've got a courage that brings me to my knees.
Hello, hi, and howdy. How's everybody doing today? I certainly hope everyone's doing great. If you're new here, welcome. If you're a return visitor, as always, welcome back. If you haven't done so and you get anything out of this content, please take a moment to like and subscribe. And if you have any case suggestions, please submit them to jenny.elisa.discusses@gmail.com and leave me a comment with your thoughts. Today's story is a suggestion from Shaniqua Jackson. And Shaniqua, if you are watching, thank you so much for the suggestion. And for everyone else, I'm going to warn you, this is a very graphic story, and it's going to be hard to hear. I know they all are, but this one's graphic, so let's jump in. Also, let me add that I'm going to do the best I can. I know y'all, some of y'all get aggravated with me with these words, but this happened in South Korea, and I'm using Google Translate to try these words, so please bear with me. Jeong-In was born on the 10th of June in 2019. She was born healthy, weighing 7 pounds and 9 ounces. At 8 days old, she was given up to a church in Seoul, South Korea, hoping to give her a better life than what her mother felt like she could give her. The first 8 months of her life, she was in foster care. Her foster mother said that she was a very happy and cheerful baby, and she said she loved to hear music. She also said she was very smart. She was standing at 6 months old. Her adoptive parents seemed to be the perfect parents on the surface. In fact, they appeared on a program by the Korea Educational Broadcasting System with both daughters to promote adoption. Jang Hae-young was born on the 4th of November in 1986. She attended the Hendong Global University. Jang also worked as an interpreter. Her father, Jang Young-gil, was a pastor in Yangdok Pohang Disciples Church, while her mother, Jang Yun-chi, owns the Big Circle Daycare Center. An Sun-jin was born on the 18th of June in 1984. He attended the Hendong Global University and worked at CBS. His father was An Hee-gil, and he was the pastor of the Andong Baptist Church. Jang and An applied to adopt a baby girl, as together they had a 4-year-old biological daughter and wanted her to have a little sister. They passed the screening process, including the psychological test, and they were qualified. In August of 2019, Jeong-in was matched with Jang and An, and in February of 2020, she moved in with them and was officially adopted. They gave her the name An Yul Ha. At this time, Jeong-in weighed 18.8 pounds and was still a happy and healthy baby girl at this time. Following the adoption, Jang and An placed Jeong-in in daycare while they worked. About 2 months after she started daycare, the daycare teachers began noticing unusual bruises on her face and ears. The bruises continued to multiply. The daycare teachers contacted the parents and said they acted highly offended, but claimed the bruising was from falling. By the 25th of May in 2020, the daycare teachers discovered bruises on her thighs, her abdomen, her neck, and she had collarbone fractures. The daycare teachers contacted the police and reported their suspicions that Jeong-in was being abused. They told the police on top of the injuries, her behavior was changing. She had become very distant and had stopped playing with the other children or her favorite toys, and she wouldn't eat her favorite snacks. They admitted to the police that they had taken the baby to the hospital without notifying the parents. When the adoptive parents were questioned, they told the police that they had massaged baby Jeong-in too hard, causing the bruises. They stated she had a condition that caused her thighs to grow slightly deformed, and they were massaged in an attempt to correct this. The police sided with the adoptive parents. They said that until there are visible cuts or broken bones, they cannot make a case against the parents. When the parents found out that the daycare workers had contacted the law, her parents made a huge scene at the daycare. On the 29th of June in 2020, a friend of Jang saw Jeong-In left in the car for over an hour. It was hot. It was a sunny day. She contacted the police, and she also got the runaround. The police did not initiate an investigation into the accusation for over a month. When they began their investigation, CCTV footage that would have been evidence of the baby left in the car had already been deleted. When asked, Jang told the authorities that it is an American-style sleep education. With no evidence, the case was closed. From July to September of 2020, Jeong-In's parents kept her out of daycare. During the same time frame, her sister attended daily. When she returned in September, the daycare teachers were just shocked. She had lost a very noticeable amount of weight, and her entire body had bruising. Even her complexion was changed. Her daycare worker took her to the clinic. She was examined by a pediatrician. The pediatrician contacted the police and informed them that he believed she was suffering from malnutrition and abuse. He told them that she needs to be removed from her home immediately, but instead the police and CPS took her to another clinic where the mother had a relationship with the doctor of some kind. It was never specified. The doctor claimed that she had a rash in her mouth and she suffered from stomatitis, causing her not to eat. The case was again closed. When asked later, the pediatrician claimed that he was never notified that there was suspected abuse, which is kind of absurd. He should have known anyway. But also during this time period, the family appeared on a television show, One Average Family, where On said, "I wanted to show the world that not only celebrities, but also people like us can choose to adopt. Adoption is not something to be ashamed of, but rather something to be celebrated." On the 12th of October, Jeong-In was at daycare. She was showing signs that she was in distress. Her teacher said that she was having a hard time standing or walking. She wasn't able to eat or drink. The teacher also noted that her stomach was abnormally swollen. They also noticed that after hours of being at daycare, her diaper was dry, indicated that urine was not passing. The teachers contacted Jang, and she went to the daycare to check on Jeong-In's condition and said she looked at Jeong-In for only a few minutes and said she was fine and there's nothing to worry about. A short time later, the teachers finally got Jeong-In to take a drink of milk. The teacher said she immediately began panting and her whole body began to shiver. It was her adopted father, On, that picked Jeong-In up from the daycare on the 12th of October. The teachers expressed their concerns for Jeong-In's health to him. They said that he forced Jeong-In to walk to him, trying to prove to the teachers that she was fine, but they could tell that it was causing her excruciating pain. They asked him to please take her to a hospital, but he refused. On the 13th of October, Jeong-In's mother made a video of her between 8:46 and 9:01 a.m. In the video, Jeong-In's mother was forcing her to walk. You could tell she was in excruciating pain, and her mother was just screaming at her and demanding she walk. At 9:40 a.m., the downstairs neighbor heard an extremely loud noise coming from the apartment. They said it sounded literally like dumbbells were falling on the ground, and it happened about 4 or 5 times in a row. The neighbors went upstairs to inquire if everything was okay. Jang answered the door and told them everything was okay and apologized for the noise. Jang then called the daycare and told them that Jeong-In would be absent that day, and she left the apartment with only her biological daughter at around 10:19 a.m. She just left Jeong-In home alone on the floor suffering. She was gone for approximately 3 hours, and when she returned, she found Jeong-In to be in a deadly condition. She sent a picture of her to her husband and asked if she should call an ambulance or a taxi to take her to the hospital. They decided on a taxi. When the taxi arrived, the driver noticed that Jeong-In was turning blue and she was unconscious. He begged Jang to call an ambulance, but she refused. Within a couple of hours of arriving at the Seoul hospital, baby Jeong-In's little body gave out and she passed away after suffering cardiac arrest 3 times. The hospital staff noted that while they were trying to save her, Jane was on her phone shopping. When she passed, hospital staff contacted the police and they reported that they suspected it was from abuse. According to an autopsy and a CT scan that was done by the National Forensic Service, Jeong-In's abdomen was full of blood, 80% of her blood. She had bone fractures in her collarbone, ribs, and arms. She had bones broken that had been self-healing that appeared to have been caused 2 to 4 months prior. She had multiple bruises on her face, neck, ears, and legs. They ruled the cause of her losing her life as amputation of her pancreas and traumatic damage to her internal organs, including severe intestinal rupture caused by heavy external forces. The forensic doctor testified that the damage to her pancreas would have required extreme force, such as someone standing on a couch or a bed and jumping off and landing on her abdominal area. He further testified that another fatal beating had occurred around 3 to 5 days before Jeong-In passed away, which would have been on a public holiday in South Korea, indicating that both parents would have been home. During the autopsy, they also found that Jeong-In only weighed 17.6 pounds at 16 months old. When they adopted her 8 months earlier, she weighed 18.8 pounds, so she had lost 1.2 pounds. The doctor who performed the autopsy also testified that in 20 years of experience, he had never seen these injuries. He said it was the worst case of abuse he had dealt with in over 3,800 bodies that he had examined. The police were finally forced to investigate what they have already been informed at least 3 times was happening. They concluded that the couple began abusing Jeong-In 1 month after adopting her. Originally, Jane was only charged with involuntary unaliving. She admitted to instances of abuse, but denied that she intended to take the life of Jeong-In. An was only charged with abuse and neglect. According to a report by Koreaboo, the adoptive parents denied the allegations against them and insisted that they had nothing to do with the passing of Jeong-In. They claimed they dropped the baby by accident. But this was proven untrue when over 800 videos of Jane abusing Jeong-In physically and mentally were found. Through the Blue House Bulletin Board, a political communication system to address citizen concerns in South Korea where the president can directly communicate with civilians, Koreans created a petition to upgrade indictments to the second type of unaliving, which is planned unaliving. For the petition to reach the president and Blue House officials, the petition must be signed by 200,000 people over a 30-day period. The petition received over 230,000 signatures by December the 20th in 2020, thus meeting the requirements to reach the government level. On the 2nd of January in 2021, Korean television series Unanswered Questions uncovered the gruesome story of what happened to Jeong-In. The public became outraged and many expressed they felt guilt. They wanted change. The abuse that baby Jeong-In suffered was so horrible. It was discovered that during the 8 months Jeong-In was in the custody of Jane and An, she was systematically tortured. She was beaten regularly, causing multiple bone fractures. She was starved because Jang and An said they did not like the smell of her feces. And to be frank, they didn't like her. When she was fed, she was served hot food right out of the microwave. It was so hot it would blister her little mouth. She was left home alone for hours at a minimum of 15 times. She was locked away alone in a dark room every night at 7 p.m. When she cried, she was slapped and punched. One time caught on video, she was strapped into a stroller and Jeong-In intentionally overturned her stroller to scare her into stop crying, which is, how would that work? In the video, Jeong-In are heard laughing loudly when they flipped over her stroller with her strapped in it. She was hung up by her arms and beat in her armpits as it was a sensitive area and would cause a lot of pain. She was also left by a pool alone for over 6 hours. Text messages between Jang and An were released. Just 20 days after the adoption of Jeong-In, on the 23rd of February in 2020, Jang texted An, "Her cough seems fake. Her nose is runny, but I'm just going to leave it." Then she texted, "My head hurts, so I'm going to take some medicine." An replied, "It's better if we raise her without giving her medication." And then he messaged, "Honey, you should take something and sleep." Later, Jang texted, "She doesn't cry when the daycare workers carry her." An responded, "Such an annoying shit." Jang responded, "She's been fussy all day. I gave her one apple today. I didn't use physical abuse today, though." An responded, "She was like that since this morning. My anger is only getting worse." Then in August, Jang texted to An, "She's going to starve until I say we can feed her." An responded, "Isn't she the worst? She's ringing in my ears. Do you want to leave her since it's annoying to bring her around? I'll go home." Jang responded with, "I'm going to leave her home, so don't come." Later, Jang texted An again with, "I think she's crazy. She won't eat." An said, "Just starve her all day." Jang replied, "You can starve for 3 days and not die." An replied, "There's a problem." To which Jang replied, "I want to curse and beat her, but I'll resist." On the 13th of October, just 271 days after being adopted and the day Jeong-In lost her life, An texted, "Take her to the hospital. It's a formality." Jang responded with, "That's probably a good idea, even though it's a hassle." Following her passing, texts were found from Jang to an acquaintance saying, "Please pray that there are no problems with her autopsy, and it seems that God needed another angel." When the details began to emerge and the public was made aware of the suffering Jeong-In went through and the failure of the police to properly investigate, social media became flooded with hashtag sorry Jeong-In. Celebrities were even using the hashtag and demanding justice. A representative from the Korea Child Abuse Prevention Association, Gong Hai Jong, kept the spotlight on Jeong-In by creating a social media challenge, the I'm Sorry Jeong-In Challenge. People from all over joined in the challenge and expressed regret that this tragedy had been allowed. In response to the controversy, the president of South Korea ordered measures to prevent this from happening again. Police Commissioner Kim Chang-ryong apologized for the system's mishandling of such cases. Politicians from both parties proposed bills for immediate removal of abused children from their parents. The Korean Lawyers Association issued a statement that the adoptive parents must be indicted for unaliving, saying, "Based on evidence gathered so far, there's no reason to not indict them for unaliving." They further said the local government must strengthen their systems to recognize child abuse by assigning more manpower. "We need more public servants in charge of investigating child abuse and a larger budget." The police and local government must cooperate as soon as a suspected case is reported. They further pointed out that in 2018 alone in South Korea, 28 children passed from abuse in their home. They said last year the government vowed to protect the rights of children, but nothing changed. Unless there is a substantial improvement, it will be an empty promise. When the case went to trial and the case gained even more attention, citizens were demanding that the officers who failed to properly investigate and mishandled the reports of abuse face consequences. Prosecutors asked that Jang receive the unaliving penalty. They asked that An be sentenced to 7 years and 6 months in prison for neglect and abuse. Jang's attorney continued to insist that while Jang admitted to abusing Jeong-In, she didn't intend to take her life. They also continue to claim that Jang did not step on Jeong-In's stomach, though the autopsy, along with the testimony from the upstairs neighbor that they heard jumping sounding like a dumbbell hitting the floor, says otherwise. Jang then said she had punched Jeong-In in the stomach for refusing to eat, but denies kicking or stomping her. The autopsy, once again, though, refuted this. It was testified that they believed the reason she stomped Jeong-In rather than punch her on this day was because she had recently undergone breast surgery. Jang stated in court that she felt the anger from the public, but she again claimed she didn't mean to unalive her. She said she punched her, but doesn't think that that is what took her life. She further told the court that she would kneel and seek forgiveness from her daughter, and that she would accept any punishment for her crime. Her charges were upgraded to intentional unaliving, and the prosecution was asking for the unalive penalty. However, she was found guilty and sentenced to life in prison. But in November of 2021, however, her sentence was reduced to 35 years in prison as the courts decided she did not intend to unalive Jeong-In. An's attorney pled for mercy for An, saying that he was not aware of the severity of the assault. They produced a letter to the court from Jang with an apology and her saying her husband did not know the entirety of the abuse. An's attorney pled for mercy for An, saying he was not aware. When the trial took place, citizens lined the sidewalk holding signs disagreeing with the sentences. The outrage did push the Korean Assembly to pass new laws to protect children, including banning corporal punishment to children. Following everything that happened, Jang and An's friends spoke out and said that they were absolutely shocked that this happened. They said both parents were so excited and eager to adopt a baby, even before adopting Jeong-In. So why did this happen? It almost seems like their intent was to adopt a child to torture, but I don't know. Well, ladies and gentlemen, this brings us to the end of the very tragic story of Jeong-In. And as always, rest easy, baby girl. Rest easy. You are free and you deserve so much more. And ladies and gentlemen, thank you all for watching. Leave me your thoughts down below in the comments section. If you have a case suggestion, once again, please send it to me at jenny.elisa.discusses@gmail.com. And if you haven't done so and you get anything out of this content, please remember to like and subscribe, as it does help the channel to grow. And until the next video, toodles.
I am equal parts, sacred and profane.